one of the ways that I think I can be most helpful to my radio audiences is by having interesting guests on the program. 9 times out of 10, I fail. I admit that. I'm sorry. Today, however, is one of those rare times when I have a genuinely fascinating guest. His name is Peter Hitchens. We've had him on before. He claims to be the brother of the late Christopher Hitchens, whom you may know. We don't have any documentation on that, so we're just going to have to take his word for it. Peter Hitchens, welcome to the program.
I'm sure if you go to Hawaii, you can get the necessary birth certificates.
Ha ha. Hey, it's always great to have you.
Well, you started it.
I know. Didn't I? It's always great to have you on. I was very happy to find an excuse to have you on. I was on Twitter the other day, and I saw that you'd written a terrific article in First Things magazine about the many people listening are going to have no idea what we're talking about. And one of the reasons I want to have you on is just to educate people who didn't know about Lady Chatterley's lover and the whole story. But you have a terrific article at First Things magazine. I put it on Twitter and on Facebook. But I thought it would be fun to have you on to discuss it. So for those people who really know nothing about Lady Chatterley's lover, give us, if you would, Peter, the background on what is this book and what was the controversy surrounding it.
All right, the book is by D.H. Lawrence, David Herbert Lawrence, a very distinguished novelist of the early part of the 20th century, though his star has waned a bit since then. A lot of literary critics at the time and afterwards thought he was very much in the great tradition of writing F.R. Leavis and others, though he's not much read now.
What are his most well-known books apart from...
I think Sons and Lovers is probably the most famous. He wrote some interesting poems as well. I'm trying to remember the titles of ones. One particular one which I remember learning by heart, I've forgotten it now, about a snake coming to a water trough to drink. He could write. He was the son of a coal miner, and he grew up with very few advantages in life. Sons and Lovers is a particularly telling book because it's autobiographical.
It's interesting that Richard Burton was also the son of a coal miner, and when you think that...
It's very possible to be the son of a coal miner and full of talent, but I think in modern Britain, if you grew up in such circumstances, your talents might not be as readily discovered as they used to be in the days when we had old-fashioned schools, but there it is. He was. Women in Love is another one which comes to mind. He got into quite a lot of trouble because of his personal life. He stole somebody's wife and children and ran away.
D.H. Lawrence.
He was accused of spying during the First World War because his wife was German. And he went off and lived for some of his time in New Mexico. But he wrote towards the end of his life the book which we're discussing, Lady Chatterley's Lover, which, in my view, is a terrible book.
Now,
it contains quite a lot of passages about fairly explicit passages about sexual intercourse and quite a lot of four-letter words.
D.H. Lawrence
Peter. Sorry, you were saying.
Yeah, no, I just want to be clear for my audience. D.H. Lawrence is someone that he's a name. There's no doubt about it. When we think of 20th century letters, he's a big deal. And in a funny way, Lady Chatterley's Lover, which is probably one of his worst works ever, but certainly the most controversial, may be how people will hear of him. Because at the end of his life, and you discuss this in your article in First Things, it was at the end of his life when he was no longer the great writer that he had been that he produces this book, which you detail as being in some ways utterly ridiculous, laughable. It's so bad, but it's held up as this great book. It's like Ulysses, James Joyce's Ulysses, that because it was controversial, it becomes the tip of the spear for freedom and the end of censorship and the end of blue-nosed prudery and this kind of thing. And so we talk about Lady Chatterley's Lover like it's some great work. But one of the main things you do in this article is you debunk that idea.
Well, I try to. I hope so. Obviously, everyone has to form his or her own judgment on it as they read it. But the difficulty with the book is that there are passages in it which are quite powerful, but they're mainly concerned with the decay of Britain and of men as men and of the countryside and landscape in the period in which it was written, which was immediately after the First World War. And some of these are quite affecting, and I wouldn't ever urge anybody not to read a book. It's something I just wouldn't do. But if you do read it, then I think you should read it very much with the fact in mind that it was used as a weapon by a faction who wanted, I think, probably not really knowing what they were doing, to change the moral atmosphere of the modern world. There have been two Lady Chatterley trials, one of which is quite famous and one of which is less well-known. The less well-known one was actually an American one.
Well, give us 1959, you said. So,
yes.
Okay,
there had been an absurdity trial in which an American judge had ruled that the literary merit of the book meant that it should be freely published.
In 1959, there was an American trial, but the famous one you say was the 1960 trial in England.
1961 in Britain, which is famous. Those people who like to think they know things know about the Chatterley trial in Britain for two reasons. One, because the prosecuting lawyer made a very crass remark in his opening speech, in which he said that he asked the jury if they would want their wives or their servants to read it, which in the England of 1960 was a ridiculous thing to say. And also because Philip Larkin's poem, Annus Mirabilis, refers to the Chatterley trial. He says that sexual intercourse began, at least for me, in 1963, between the end of the Chatterley ban and the Beatles' first LP. A lot of people are very familiar with that quotation, and so it's embedded itself in the half-heard, half-remembered minds of many, many people as a result.
But Peter Larkin comes out of the world.
They know about it.
But yeah, I was going to say it's well known, and I'm one of those people who I think I know a little bit of everything, and of course I've heard of Lady Chatterley's Lover. I think that, you know, when you get a cultural education, you pick up these things. The line from the Philip Larkin poem is itself famous enough. I've heard of it before. Maybe I only remember it because I was born in 1963. But at the same time, Philip Larkin.
Are you a teenager? You're so young.
Yes, I'm a child. I'm a very child. It's amazing they gave me a radio program. But the thing is this, that Philip Larkin, what you talk about in your article is this milieu in England, which I credit you with opening my eyes to how what happened in the 60s in America happened in Great Britain after the First War. This disillusion with institutions, with government, with the church. And in a funny way, this trial in 1961 is one of it's one of the manifestations of what had been happening over the previous decades.
I think it has a connection, but I think connection is more oblique. It happened in about the same time as our famous Profumo scandal, in which a government minister for defense, in fact, had been caught sleeping with a prostitute who he had shared with the Soviet naval attaché in the Soviet embassy in London. A huge scandal developed about this. In fact, no secrets escaped through it. It was just a matter of a man misbehaving in his private life. But it was very revelatory for most people to find this conservative government minister.
By the way, forgive me for cutting you off. Forgive me for cutting you off. We have to go to a break. But before we go to the break, I want to say it's pronounced revelatory. You, sir, were quite incorrect. We're going to be right back, and we're going to discuss that mispronunciation and many more things when we come back.
Yeah.
Hey, folks, it's the Eric Metaxas Show. We go from the Ohio players to the great Peter Hitchens, who's on the line right now. We're discussing his article in the current issue of First Things magazine about Lady Chatterley's Lover, the infamous novel, and the trial, the Lady Chatterley's Lover trial for obscenity. Peter Hitchens, again, welcome to the program.
It's nice to be back.
Yes, and it's always nice to have you back. This is there's a moment, you talk about this in the article, but in a funny way, the Lady Chatterley's Lover controversy, the trial, it's really one of those moments when you look at culture, the sweep of culture, how things change, how things develop, not only because Philip Larkin mentions it in his poem, but I think maybe even if he hadn't mentioned it in his poem, you look at it, at least I look at it, as one of those moments, one of those milestones in our culture of the degradation of standards and those kinds of things. And I think you capture that in your article. Maybe you can talk a little bit more about that.
It's not so much a matter of standards. It's a matter of, honestly, it's a matter of law. That what had existed before had been, there was a secret or semi-secret subculture of filth available in grubbier parts of London, presumably other big towns, where people who wanted to buy dirty books and pornographic material could risk doing so. And it was a risk because if they were seen by respectable people, it would be highly embarrassing for them. And it could possibly sometimes be illegal because they might get caught in raids. But the police, possibly through laxity, possibly through corruption, allowed these places to exist in certain parts of the towns. And there it was. But it was disapproved of, and it was disgraceful. And it was generally kept within fairly tight limits. Anybody who wanted to buy the unexpurgated edition of Lady Chatterley's Lover with all the dirty bits in it could go to France and buy it, and with a bit of luck, they could get it past customs on the way home, unless they were very...
But that's very funny. I mean, to think back that almost within my lifetime, certainly within your lifetime, we lived in a world where to buy, quote-unquote, dirty books in England, one had to go to a disreputable part of town. It was illegal, whether they were able to pull it off or not. It's like getting pot in New York. You can do it, but it's technically it's illegal. Or go all the way across the channel to France and then have to smuggle it back again illegally. Anything smuggled is smuggled illegally. But the idea that not very long ago, that was the world in which we lived, this trial of this really mediocre at best novel by this famous novelist, it changed all that.
Well, it did. And it also changed, and this has been very important in modern Britain, it changed the attitude towards people's readiness to use four-letter words. A lot of the trial was actually about the four-letter words which pepper the book in quite large numbers, and which hadn't been spoken really in public places before, which the prosecuting lawyer made a point of speaking out loud in court. So there was that too.
He was the Lenny Bruce of his day.
But the thing was that the real change was that this defense, which had been put together, had in fact been used also in the American case in 1959, that although the book might technically be obscene by any classification, its publication was justified by literary merit of some kind. And the new English law, which had been in place for a very short time before the trial took place, said more or less the same thing. It's very interesting how that law came into being. But whether anybody on the side of conservatism decided to have a test case or whether the test case was really provoked by the liberals is very hard to tell from what happened. Fascinating thing about the trial, possibly the most single fascinating fact about it to me, is that there were no prosecution witnesses against Lady Chatterley.
You mean against, not the character, of course, but against the book?
No, against the book. There was a technical prosecution witness who was the police officer who'd gone to the publishers and obtained 12 copies of the book so that it could be technically stated the book had been published and was therefore subject to the law. And the publishers were themselves, therefore, the object of the prosecution. But apart from that, there were no prosecution witnesses. All the witnesses who were called were defense witnesses of an intellectual and literary type who proceeded in a long trail into the witness box to say what a wonderful book it was and what a superb author Lawrence was and how it was absolutely wrong to prevent the book from being published. I mean, no intellectuals, literary critics, or experts were prepared to say in the witness box in that court that they didn't think it was a very good book.
Now, do you think it's because the climate in literary circles in England at that time was already such that to say to be on the wrong side of this was to be on the wrong side of history, just as we are now feeling with same-sex marriage?
The wrong side of history is a bit of a Marxist formulation.
Of course it is. That's why I just said
fashion.
It. That's why I said it.
Of fashion. It was the wrong side of fashion that they were on.
But listen, of course it's the wrong side of fashion. The wrong side of history, you're quite right. It's a Marxist formulation, but it's being used today.
Well,
it's a bludgeon.
It characterizes history as an actor in events rather than.
But that's the point. That's the point. In other words, that's the worldview of Marxists. It's the worldview of the fascists in our culture today. They pretend.
Yeah, but I'm not accusing these people of that. I'm accusing them of being lazy, a bit cowardly, and very much in the grip of fashion and being afraid to speak out against something which in their hearts they must have known was at least faulty. A few years later, you may remember there's controversy about a book called Last Exit to Brooklyn by Hewitt Selby, which was eventually made into a film, astonishingly enough. And one of Britain's leading booksellers, Basil Blackwell, who then owned the great bookshop in Oxford where I live, was called as a witness, and he said, when asked whether the book depraved or corrupted its readers, he said, yes, I believe it does. And the defense lawyer, thinking to have a bit of sport, said, and did it deprave and corrupt you, Sir Basil? And he said, yes, indeed it did. I wish to God I'd never read it. It's poisoned my mind. And so that was a defense ploy which failed. But there was nobody prepared to do anything that brave in the case of Lady Chatterley, though, interestingly enough, if they'd looked for someone, they could have found someone. And, I mentioned at length in the article Catherine Ann Porter, who some of your listeners may know of as the author of that very fine book, Ship of Fools, which I just read for the first time as a result of reading her thoughts on Lady Chatterley. And she wrote a devastating article about Lady Chatterley in Encounter magazine, then probably the premier intellectual magazine at the time, that ran into trouble later, in which she denounces as a dreary and foolish book containing, as she said, unintentional, hilarious, low comedy, one seen at least simply beyond belief in a book written with such inflamed apostolic solemnity. And it's a savage, but absolutely just condemnation.
God bless Catherine Ann Porter.
If she had come across the Atlantic to give evidence, she would have countered all the rest and shown them up for what they were, but nobody bothered to get it to come. And so all the, whether they were bishops or academics from Cambridge or whoever, or sociologists or magazine editors or whoever they were, they all queued up to say what a wonderful book this is and there couldn't be any
but
possible
reason to criticize
it.
What's fascinating to me is that we had a literary, artistic, cultural elite already in 1961 who seemed to be where they have been ever since, that they are...
This had already happened by then, but it hadn't spread out into the culture in the way that it subsequently has.
Well, I guess that's what I'm saying, is that you talk about the Fabians, Bloomsbury, that these things... They happen in stages, that a culture, the decline of a culture, the decline of our culture has happened in stages, that there are these small elite groups that initially they're announced, and then a couple of decades later, they're running everything. You talk about that.
Well, I think in this case, there's a particular force which makes it important. The Bloomsbury Group, of course, was really a group of people which began to exist before the First World War and carried on into the 20s and 30s. And they were largely insignificant to those who'd never heard of them. And publishing books and small magazines was never going to make much difference. The real break that these people had, it came in the 1950s and 1960s, when broadcasting began to become mass entertainment, And when many of them had, I'm not quite sure why it happened, but it definitely did happen, had found their way into broadcasting.
Okay, forgive me, we're going to go to a break. I want to pick up that point when we come back. Folks, I'm talking to Peter Hitchens. It's the Eric Metaxas Show. Our website, MetaxasTalk.com. We'll be right back. My life is going to be.
Oh, the sun's going to shine in my life once more. Love's going to live here again. Things are going to be the way they were before. Love's going to live here again.
Hey, folks, it's the Eric Metaxas Show. That is Buck Owens. I'm Eric Metaxas, and my guest is Peter Hitchens. Peter, you were just saying when we went to the break that a lot of the people who had been obscure, part of the Bloomsbury group, something happened in the 50s. Suddenly, they're running broadcasting, the BBC. I feel like it's the same thing that happened, that the 60s happened in America, and then suddenly in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, all of those people are running these institutions. They have become, they were a small group, and then they become the cultural elites. They're running things, and they are codifying what was on the outs just a few decades earlier.
Yes, well, I think this is true, and I think the invasion of broadcasting by people whose views a generation before were on the eccentric edge of academic and cultural life is an astonishing story which needs to be examined and told. I'm not sure quite how it came to be, but perhaps there was some particular reason why people in publishing and small magazines found broadcasting so attractive. But I think also the state-sponsored nature of the BBC, its completely metropolitan position where if you weren't in London, you didn't really matter. And the fact that these people were fluent in front of a microphone and knew a lot, there's no question that the Bloomsburys and the Fabians knew a lot, made them particularly suited to this. And the other thing is that they possibly saw very quickly the opportunity it gave them, whereas the sort of conservative people, they go into what you might call ordinary trades and professions. They don't go into intellectual activities as such. They might become lawyers, or maybe engineers, or scientists, or businessmen, or soldiers. But they don't naturally tend towards the arty end of the professional spectrum.
I have a theory.
The left do it, and here we have it. There is some work to be done on this, because it's not just because the BBC is a state sponsored and organization financed by a poll tax that is like this. You could say very much the same about the big American networks, which are entirely private in nature.
I have a theory.
It does seem to attract the left to it.
Hey, Pete.
It does seem to nurture them when they get there.
Hey, Pete, I've got a theory. Listen to tell me what you think of this, because I think this is what is dispositive. Okay, I think that the rise of mass media itself enabled voices that would have been sequestered in these minority cultural communities to be, broadcast, to be magnified, so that you have what is happening in America today. You have people whose views are in the minority being presented as though they're the only view. If you tune into mainstream media today in America, and this is going all the way back, you get the views of people who live in Manhattan, typically. They all believe the same things. You know the famous line, Pauline Kael, the critic, the film critic of The New Yorker, famously or infamously said in 1972 that she didn't know anyone who had not voted for McGovern. In other words, there are these tiny communities, but because of the advent of the media, the mass media, suddenly those voices are magnified and multiplied. That was impossible, let's say, in the 19th century or in the early part of the 20th century. With the advent of radio and then with TV, all of that changed. What do you think?
Well, I think it's true. And I just think it is just what happened. And it's one of the great failures of moral and social conservatism, that it didn't understand it when it began, or combat it, or try to match it, or in any way try to prevent it. And we are now where we are largely because of that failure.
And you and I are voices crying in the wilderness.
Well, I'm not sure it's the wilderness yet, but we're certainly marginal. I mean, one of the things about it makes me quite amused to remember that the left used to claim that the tool of the capitalist state against them was something called repressive tolerance. I think it was a Marcuse phrase, where they were allowed to, they were tolerated so liberally because not to tolerate them would strengthen them. I think the left didn't really suffer very much from that, but they certainly learned from it. They tolerate you and me. We're not in the wilderness. We don't die of starvation or lack bread to feed our children, but we are fundamentally ineffectual because we can't reach major audiences.
I don't want to forget, we're talking about Lady Chatterley's Lover and that trial.
We were, yeah.
In 1961. Yes, principally we've been talking about that. But I want to ask you about Ulysses and James Joyce, because I thought that these questions had been settled not in 1961, but in the 30s when Ulysses was controversial.
Well, I simply can't go into that, because if there was a trial on that score, then I don't know of it. But I think you'd find that in 1931, or thereabouts, the obscenity laws of England and probably most states in the USA would have pretty much banned the open sale of unexpurgated editions of Ulysses. And no one would have tried. All kinds of things were banned in those days because banning happened, and literary merit was not acceptable as a defense if obscenity could be proved.
Well, so the difference with
Lady Chatterley is not that the state and the authorities didn't try to ban it, it's that they failed to ban it.
Okay, well, another break. We'll be right back talking to Peter Hitchens. The Eric Metaxas Show. I'm Eric Metaxas. The music is by Henry Mancini, and my guest is Peter Hitchens. Peter, again, welcome to the program.
Nice to be back again.
That's so positive of you. I'm not used to that.
Don't worry, I'll undo it shortly.
Okay, thank you. I'm just looking on the internet now in Wikipedia about the controversy around Ulysses. It's not really clear what happened. But I guess it would seem to me that paved the way for what would follow with Lady Chatterley's Lover. In other words, to have a literary class in England unwilling to take a stand against obscenity or even to speak out against the book, it just strikes me that culturally speaking, this ground was prepared in previous decades, and in part by Ulysses. James Joyce's Ulysses, that the work was thought to be so great by so many people, even though it was obscene. It is obscene in certain parts. So this didn't happen in a vacuum. It didn't happen suddenly, is my point with Lady Chatterley's Lover.
No, I don't think anyone suggested there's any suddenness about it. It is a particular moment at which, in your country and in mine, the courts make law. And the decision that was handed down had completely changed the nature of publishing, completely changed the nature of what people were prepared to have sold in public, and also what they were prepared to say and the sort of language they were prepared to use. It wasn't that immediately after the Chatterley trial, middle-class educated people started using four-letter words in their own homes and in public and on television. But it began an intellectual process which would lead to that, which is where we are now in Britain, where these words are in constant use. And as I said, they're in constant use not just by rude people in bars who've had too much to drink, but among otherwise respectable people who will suddenly burst out into streams of four-letter words.
It can happen.
That is a major setback, it seems to me, in civilization. And also, the whole barrier which used to exist, which kept pornography as an unrespectable thing, which most people stayed away from, has disappeared completely. So pornography is now no longer illegal and is the most accessed thing on the internet. In fact, I think probably what keeps the internet warm.
Well, yes. That's my way of saying yes. When you talk about the law, you can understand the other point of view, right? That the law is, there's something clumsy about law. We know that the law is a teacher. The law is important, but it can be clumsy and it can be wielded in a clumsy way. And I think to some extent, repressive laws can cause the whole thing to backfire, right?
Eric.
Go ahead.
There was every single one of the witnesses at the Chatterley trial, academics, journalists, ordinary citizens, clergymen, all of them had read Lady Chatterley's Lover in an unexpurgated edition. Educated, middle-class people could obtain this stuff if they wanted to. The whole point was that the masses could not. The proposal was to sell this book in an ordinary paperback publication, which in those days cost 3 shillings and 6 pence in the proper English money we used to have then, which translated in 1960 values to about 45 cents in U.S. money at the time. And so instead of it just being something that people with university degrees and some education and background could read if they really wanted to and buy, it became a mass commodity. And that is a difference. And every society can tolerate a certain amount of seediness and pornography at its edge. And that's something which it has to be tolerated because you can't create a utopia where none of these things will happen. But it's when it decides that this sort of thing should enter the mainstream of culture that things change. And that's what happened. And of course, one of the main effects it has been on broadcasting, where again, you can hardly see a major drama now in which you don't have to watch, whether you want to or not, people in bed together having sexual intercourse. And even, for goodness sake, in what's otherwise an extremely good dramatization of Evelyn Waugh's Brideshead Revisited, we had to put up with Jeremy Irons and I think Diana Quick having it away in a stateroom on board a transatlantic liner, because it's become obligatory now to show the sex act all the time.
The word is obligatory, sir. Please, this is an American audience.
That's what you think.
This is an American audience.
Just a colonial.
Thank you. Okay,
I
so
can't help that.
You're
don't tell me how to speak English.
I shan't. I shan't do it again.
I won't tell you how to speak American.
Okay, what you just said, I mean, I think what happened, I don't know if it was a result of this Lady Chatterley's Lover trial.
It
well, let me finish, because you don't even know what I'm.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. Okay, hang on. What I was going to say is that in the 60s, it became fashionable, as you said, to write these kinds of things. John Updike, to me, is probably the guiltiest of them all. Here's a man who knew how to write well. Something happened to him after the publication of The Centaur in 1964, and he became 100%.
You've become very faint all of a sudden.
I've become faint. Well, the oxygen's thin on this side of the pond.
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
I can.
You can. I was saying that it strikes me that John Updike is particularly guilty because after the publication of his book, The Centaur, in 1964, something happened and he became almost entirely ribald in his writing. Most famously, in 1968, he published the book Couples. And after that, he lived out this lie, and he was explicit about it. He said that these kinds of things, the sexual act, they need to become part of our fiction, as though writing explicitly was the only way to handle these things in fiction, in literary fiction. We have to go to break. We'll have a final segment with Peter Hitchens in just a moment. It's the Eric Metaxas Show. Stick around. Here's a little Tom Jones.
It's not unusual. It happens every day. No matter what you say.
She came with the rain. Scarlet ribbon in her hair. I never even knew her name. She just slipped away from me to who knows where. And if it weren't for the rain, she might still be there. Rainmaker, does she have to be free?
Hey folks, it's the Eric Metaxas Show. I'm talking to Peter Hitchens, just a few minutes left. Peter, I was just saying that this kind of thinking, I don't know if it was as a result of the Lady Chatterley's Lover trial, but it strikes me that this view that high art could now include vulgarity really ran the table in the 1960s. And by the time you get to the end of the 60s, it's game over.
Well, it not just could, I think, but increasingly that it should.
Yeah.
That it didn't, really count unless it did. I'm trying at the moment to, as an experiment, to write about my own experiences of the late 1960s because I find them increasingly perplexing. It's a very difficult era to describe, but things did go further then than ever before or since, I think, what people were prepared to do. And one of the most fascinating things about the 60s is that they ended. Although we live now in an era completely influenced by them, even now, I think people would be quite shocked by how far people went during that age. But yes, it went from being permitted to being pretty much obligatory.
When you say obligatory,
I think the Chatterley trial was important. When you open a sluice gate, what comes through it is your responsibility. And we did it. We did open a sluice gate. And I think those who did it either blinded themselves to the consequences of it or knew about it and didn't care. And it would be very interesting now to go back and ask them, if one could, how much they'd understood about what they were doing. Some of them, I think, understood very well. Others were just passive.
Well, these things take courage. And apart from Catherine Ann Porter, it seems that nobody had courage.
It's a great pity about that, but... What if they had? I wonder how different would things have been. But here's an interesting thing, which I think I owe to Aldous Huxley, and also to the, oddly enough, the Marxist historian Eric Hobsbawm. There is no connection directly between sexual freedom and political freedom. That is to say, there's no reason to suppose that it's a society in which the loins are free. Is a society in which the mind will be free.
I would say it's just the opposite. They're antithetical, aren't they? Yeah, they're antithetical. There's no question about it in my mind.
I think that there's been a lot of people confuse these things, just as people will say to me when I criticize drug legalization. So surely you believe in liberty. And I say, well, indeed, I do believe in the liberty of speech, thought, and assembly. But I don't think that encompasses the liberty to stupefy myself and make myself a passive subject of any despot who happens to come along. I think it's a completely different thing. But people believe that these liberties, which allow them greater personal autonomy and the complete freedom to do what they will with their own bodies, are equivalent to the great political freedoms, which quite often have been embraced by people who've taken exactly the opposite view.
Well, it seems to me that rather than being at the end of the program, we ought to be at the beginning. But, alas, we're at the end. I will have to have you back, Peter, if you'll consent to it. It's always...
I consent.
All right. It's always instructive, edifying, and entertaining to speak with you. Thanks for being my guest, folks. It's the Eric Metaxas Show. Please tell your friends about this program. You can find us on podcast and, of course, at metaxastalk.com. Thank you for listening.